There is a Kabir here. ये जिस्म प्यार करना नहीं जानता कबीर, ये जानता है तो सिर्फ भूख, जिस्म की भूख. स्लीजी. वेल, बिपाशा मेड इट लुक हॉट एंड इट वॉज माई जॉब टू मेक इट साउंड कूल, नॉट स्लीजी. डू वी हैव अ रमेश हियर? एक चुटकी सिंदूर की कीमत तुम क्या जानो रमेश बाबू. ईश्वर का सर का ताज होता है एक चुटकी सिंदूर. सुहागन का सर का ताज होता है एक्चुअली एक चुटकी सिंदूर. हर औरत का ख्वाब होता है एक चुटकी सिंदूर. आई नो दीज डायलॉग्स साउंड रिडिक्युलस बट इट इज द जॉब ऑफ अ वॉइस आर्टिस्ट टू मेक देम बिलीवेबल. And yes, my voice is my asset. It has become my identity. It defines me. It's given me everything I have. And I think it draws people to me. Not my face, not my name, just my voice. It's always had a greater impact than anything else. And even though I've moved on to voice coaching, dubbing direction, dubbing production, I think this will still remain my strongest identity. But was this ever a career choice? Nah, this was my passion, not my career. I mean, I wanted to do something far more mainstream, something far more cool, identifiable, popular, more dignified. I had all the preconceived notions of the ideal career. Education was everything in my family. And obviously, it led me to the most obvious career choices. And back in the day, who knew voice acting was a career, right? I mean, yeah, sure, I had a way with words. I loved language. I loved to read out loud. I loved poetry. I probably got that from my parents, who were in advertising. Someone must have been looking for a child voice sometime, and they must have taken me to a studio. Must have worked out well. And thus began my affair with the world of voicing. But I never really took it seriously. It was always just a hobby. Something for fun, for pocket money. And I was a shy child. I kind of lived inside a shell. But I came alive when I was alone within the four walls of a recording room, playing myriad characters, living out every fantasy. And the moment I was out of that room, I'd be back inside my shell. So it's taken a lot for me to come out here and speak in front of an audience today. Forgive me if I go blank. But I'm looking at the bright side. I'm the eternal optimist. I see this as a catharsis, as a forced introspection. And since everybody else has said such wonderful things, I think I'm only left with my story. The biggest influence in my life was my mother. She was a remarkable woman with a never-say-die attitude. I've derived everything from her training, guidance, and philosophy. When I was 8, she was posted in London with the Indian Tourism Office. We were really excited. So after a lot of preparation, we moved there, and I went to primary school. But I was teased for my Indian accent. And that was quite a bit of racism, so I was desperate to blend in. So I had to quickly acquire a British accent and make every effort to fit in. But when I came home again, I had to fit back in, right? So I had to lose it again. And this taught me to switch effortlessly between accents. My mom was also a professional singer back in Mumbai. So she became very popular with the Indian, Pakistani, and Bangladeshi communities in London. Even though she had a full-time job, her love for the performing arts made her grab every opportunity there was to perform and grow artistically. And she encouraged me to do so as well. And soon her love for the performing arts rubbed off on me. I mean, sure, like every good Bengali, I had a little bit of training in Rabindrasangeet, in music, in dance, in drama. No, wait, Bengalis don't need training in drama. It's in the blood. So we blended in beautifully with the Asian cultural scene in London. And whenever I came back home, my father would teach me to read and write Bengali, so I learned a little bit of that too. My mother was always wondering how I'd cope with Hindi when I came back. So she had carried her my Hindi books for me to study. She also asked me to write down the lyrics of songs sometimes, which she had to perform at a show because she didn't know them. And in those days, the only way you could take down lyrics was by playing the audio cassette over and over and over and writing down the words, writing down every line. And I did that for her regularly. Subconsciously, I learned music, diction, poetry, language, Hindi, Bengali, Oriya, Punjabi, Urdu, so many things. When we moved back to India, I'd lost touch with the world of voicing. The education system here sucked the life out of me, and there was no time for anything else. But meanwhile, my parents had started going through a difficult phase, personally and professionally. So my mom suggested that I get back to voicing while I was in college for some extra income. So she asked me to go meet a very senior voice coordinator. I went and met him. And I said, look, I speak English, Hindi, Bengali, and Oriya fluently. So can I please have some opportunities in these languages? And he said, do you read and write these languages? I said, well, not exactly. I can write in English. So he said, well, you have to learn because it's not going to be easy to read a script and get work if you don't know the language. But he started me off nevertheless. Now, like many of my ambitious friends, I wanted to study computer engineering and pursue business management. This was my career plan, plan number one. So I started applying to engineering colleges in India and abroad. I was offered a BS degree with internship at NASA. I thought my life was made. But we couldn't afford it, and I had to pass up the opportunity. I didn't make the cut for engineering colleges here either, so I decided to do the next best thing, get a BSc degree, and maybe then pursue business management. I still wasn't thinking of voicing as a career. Around this time, my mother had started getting offers to direct the language dubs of various films and TV shows that were being dubbed from one language to another. And dubbing became so popular over time that my mom had to quit her 20-year-old job and turn full-time dubbing director. Soon, my voicing career also started taking off with advertising. And I was getting a lot of opportunities, a lot of appreciation. I started off with Oriya, which had the smallest talent pool, then moved on to Bengali, which had a bigger talent pool, and then slowly to Hindi and then to English. I'd also started helping my mom with her work. And as I graduated from college, one of my mom's clients offered me a job as a dubbing coordinator in a production house that was creating content for a soon-to-be-launched TV channel. It was exciting for me. I mean, I was the youngest in the office. I had the experience for the job, and I had the enviable option of working flexi time. I could come and go as I pleased. It was a great experience. I learned the workings of the corporate world, and I learned how to do business. But it was a tough balancing act, trying to do voicing, trying to help my mom with her work, trying to do this job. So after a couple of years, I had to quit. And finally, I accepted that I was going to be a voice artist. I'd started dubbing for actresses in mainstream Hindi cinema. And with every film that became popular and every actress that became popular, producers started seeing me as a lucky mascot for their films. And this was scary, because if a film did well, it's fine. If it doesn't, then I'm in danger too. But now that I'd decided that this was going to be my career, I started working on my language skills, on my diction, and pretty much anything that could come in the way of a great delivery. When I'd moved back from London, I had braces and this had started affecting my speech a little bit. So when my braces came off, I had a terrible lisp. And I did everything in my power to get rid of it. Because otherwise, I mean, my career would be gone, right? Which I just accepted. I started loving every moment of my work. I loved making magic with words, with exploring my voice, with pushing my boundaries. And every director and sound engineer I worked with taught me more and more about the creative and technical aspects of my work. My mom's work had also taken off in a similar manner, and she was now the proud founder of our dubbing company, Sound and Vision India. Every studio and production house in India and abroad wanted to work with her. And even though I was the voice for some of her projects, I didn't want to work with her full time and get tied down to the dubbing industry alone. I wanted to be free. And voicing gave me that freedom. It gave me the financial freedom and independence to be footloose and fancy free. And so long as I had my freedom, I was happy to help my mom from the sidelines. During this time, I met my husband, got married. But as I went along, something kept telling me that this is not enough, I need to do more. Now, as a dubbing producer, we often face the dilemma of always needing fresh talent, but never really finding the right kind of people with the right skill and experience. So I decided to start training, and I thought this was a great retirement plan. Plan number two. Well, I say retirement plan because I'd been married a while now and I thought it would be great to start a family. So I started my own little dubbing studio close to home where I could record my own scripts and train voices. I couldn't find a teacher's training program, so I started training people informally from my own experiences. I thought I'd found the perfect way to slow down, cut back, and still remain connected to what I knew best. And this was going perfectly, till one fine day my mother passed away. This was a complete shocker. It was too unexpected. Someone so professional, iconic, so committed, so hardworking, loving, caring, compassionate, had just vanished from our lives. And we didn't have the time to grieve. There was a massive business to run, studios and offices to take care of, clients to take care of, projects to be delivered, salaries to be paid, and most importantly, a legacy to protect. The dubbing industry was in shock. You know, people, employees started leaving us, people started banging on our doors, asking for funds, asking for their money. And there was nothing we could do about it because the banks had frozen our accounts. My mother was the sole proprietor who passed away without a will. And all I had to run this company was my own little business account, which I was running in parallel for my little studio. So I picked up the pieces and started rebuilding the company. Our clients were very encouraging and very supportive, and that's what kept us going. Soon after this setback, within a month in fact, I got the second shocker of my life. I was expecting twins. I mean, after all that anticipation and waiting to have a child, they were coming at a time when I would have absolutely no time for them, when I couldn't even rejoice at their arrival. I had such a beautifully crafted retirement plan, but it eluded me. Life had other plans. I felt like I was being dragged by a leash and I just had to trudge along. At a time when I wanted to cut back and slow down, I had to work harder than I'd ever worked in my life. All through my pregnancy, I ran three offices, one of my own and two of my mom's. Eventually, when the babies came, this became impossible. So my husband and I decided that we should consolidate our operations, bring them closer home so that I could manage my babies and my work effectively. This move worked wonders for us. Amazing opportunities came our way. And we started growing and expanding exponentially. I got to work on the best of projects with the best of talent from the Indian film industry. And before I knew it, I was in an enviable position of power, responsibility, and respect. Little did I know that this career that I gave so little importance to would give me so much in return. And as I narrate this to you, my mother's words ring loud and clear. She always said, never say no to anything. You never know what comes out of what. So here I am, the sum total of all the little influences and experiences that went into making the smaller picture. I don't think anything different would have had the same result, do you? No matter what I planned, life kept challenging me with new situations. I had no time to ponder over problems, I just had to find a solution. I didn't have the luxury of choice, I just had to do what was required of me. And it didn't turn out so badly after all, did it? I didn't know my calling. I didn't see it, even though it was right there. But I always took great pride in whatever I did. And I realize that every moment, every day, every situation presents us with an opportunity to excel. What we do with that opportunity is what defines us. So don't ignore the smaller picture. It's what makes the bigger picture. Find your voice, your identity. Thank you.